respected elders, friends, colleagues, it is a great fortune to be here and be part of the proceedings of a topic that is most pertinent to all of us in any sphere of life, particularly so management. And where better to discuss and deliberate on the Bhagavad Gita than in God's own country. Together, I hope to actually explore with all of you the close connection between management and Bhagavad Gita, and more importantly, hopefully, experience the principles enshrined in this immortal text by adopting the practice of the heart, of a simple heartfulness, relaxation, and meditation. Hence, the title of this talk is about actualizing the principles of the Bhagavad Gita in management through heartfulness. As you'll see, this is an intersection of three circles. There's Bhagavad Gita, there is management, and then there is heartfulness. Therefore, the way this session is organized, or the way we've conceptualized the session, is only partly about explanation and discussion, but more importantly about experience. On a lighter note, and if I may make an admission, this is also my way of sparing you from me. Because honestly speaking, I am by no stretch of imagination any sort of a scholar in Sanskrit, as any of my predecessors have been, and have a very modest and limited understanding of the sacred texts. By no means can I claim to be an adept in management, and least of all in something like heartfulness meditation, which even after 20 years I've realized I'm just about scratching the surface. So I thought what would be most valuable to all of you is really the experience and less my explanation. But nevertheless, let's start with a little bit of context and background to explore the parallels and then get to the experience. Perhaps we start in the field of management, and to give it the touch of cool that Girish was referring to in the earlier session, let's go back to the 1970s to the field of sport, which actually formed the basis of what today is practiced as sports psychology and the basis of a lot of professional business coaching. It dates back to a rather popular coach by the name of Timothy Galvin, who actually came up, who is known to be one of the founders of the field of sports psychology, and who came up with a very simple equation that represented his teaching. He simply said, performance is equal to potential minus interference. He said performance is equal to potential minus interference. That was a simple expression of everything that he meant to say. Now what he really meant was the following. What Timothy Galvin meant was that every sphere of activity that we engage in, whether it be management, whether it be sport, whether it be anything that we do in life, has two aspects to it. It has an outer aspect, which is the activity itself, that we are all engaged in at any point in time. And equally so, and by the way, the outer activity is visible to all of us. We all agree. Whatever we engage in, whether we talk, whether we listen, it's all visible. But parallelly, there is also an inner activity that is going on in the mind that is invisible. So what Galvin said in this equation is that peak performance, performance equal to potential minus interference. So peak performance happens when the mind is least disturbed through a series of interferences in the action. These interferences, he later figured out in the field of sport, is nothing but the following: fear of losing a point, hankering for victory or success after a point, lot of judgment that goes on as chatter. I don't know how many of us here have played some sort of a sport competitively. Can we have a show of hands? I used to play competitive tennis as a little boy. At 30-40, when I tossed up the ball, I would only hope no double fault, no double fault. That happens in the backdrop, and that interferes with the process of actually playing in the moment. So what Galway says is these interferences take away from the effectiveness of an action. On the contrary, he figured out and he explained that when one is devoid of these interferences caused by overemphasis on what he called victory and defeat and so forth, and instead absorbed in the moment, absorbed in the activity totally, then one is in a state of what we call flow. Somebody, I think, when I referred to videos, referred to Roger Federer. And how many of us have seen Roger Federer play? When they are really focused, they are completely in the zone. It is a state of what Galway describes as relaxed concentration. This is the state in which a player is most effective in the zone. And contrary to popular belief, that is a state when the player is not preoccupied with victory. He is not preoccupied with victory, he is just absorbed in the moment. And as you can appreciate, it is applicable to any field of life. So what Galway went about doing is he, on the back of this theory, he actually transformed the way he started teaching tennis or coaching tennis. It was not enough to just give a theory. He transformed the way he taught tennis and said, listen, rather than, you know, instructing people on the technical skills of playing, how to hit a forehand, how to hit a serve, how to hit a backhand, he started moving away from that concept and started teaching by encouraging the students to simply observe without judgment both their own game and the way he played. And said when they did that without self-criticism, without judgment, without anything else, the unconscious mind naturally imbibes the techniques and the technique evolves by its own. Therefore, his method of teaching transformed from instructional teaching to teaching that imbibe, where students could imbibe the essence of the technique, and also later when they got out in a competitive setting, they could play without the disturbance and interference of the mind itself. In other words, what Galway was saying, that as important as is the outer actions that we do, equally important is the inner, what he called in his world, the inner game. And therefore, he laid much more emphasis on cultivating the inner game as opposed to just creating the techniques. Therefore, his books were published, Inner Game of Tennis, Inner Game of Golf, and it became the foundation of sports psychology, and later went on to also penetrate into the corporate world. And his teaching, the inner game of work, and it formed the basis of a lot of our professional coaching today. For example, encouraging people to reflect, encouraging teaching by asking questions, encouraging people to enjoy the now, the present moment, times of essence that Vinay was talking about, being immersed in the now. So this was essentially what Galway's theory was. Once again, performance equal to potential minus interference. Focus as much on the inner game and ensure that we reach a state of being where the interferences are minimal. That's what makes one perform at peak potential. Okay. One circle, which is the circle of management, which is the circle of life. Let's now come back to our own immortal text, the Bhagavad Gita, and explore the parallels. And it's striking actually to see the parallels in some way. As I promised, I'm not any sort of an expert in the scriptures, but I'll try and put it in layman's terms. And I've drawn some of my inspiration and some of my, as I prepared for this, from the works of Sri Vinoba Bhave, who actually rendered a beautiful series of talks while in jail, serving this term during India's strife for freedom. He delivered a series of about 19 lectures that gives a very simple, lucid and practical orientation to the Bhagavad Gita. So Sri Vinoba Bhave says that perhaps without stating it as explicitly, Lord Krishna too had a wonderful equation that he communicated to Arjuna. And that equation he tantamounts to the following formula: karma plus vikarma is equal to akarma. And what he basically when goes about saying is, what does Lord Krishna say essentially, karma? What does he say on that aspect? He motivates, encourages, exhorts Arjuna to perform his swadharma or duty. And performance of that swadharma or duty is paramount. It is one's sacred duty. It is like one's calling. It is like one's nature. So he says that there is no scenario in which fulfillment or excellence or success or anything can be accomplished without performing one's swadharma. The nature of that action per se is irrelevant. Whether it be, you know, if you parallel it to the corporate world, whether one is a CEO or one is a security person is not the issue that we are dealing with here. What is relevant here is performance of one's duty, which is what he calls karma. Right? There are the other regular aspects of karma like eating, drinking and all that, we are not referring to that here. The second part of the equation, vikarma, what is that referring to? What the Lord is telling Arjuna is that performance of swadharma or karma is only a necessary condition, it's not sufficient. What is equally important is the attitude with which that karma is performed, the state of mind, the mental frame of mind with which that attitude is performed. And that is what he terms as vikarma. And what are and what is that state of mind in which the work is to be performed? He at least gives, I just state three examples. He says, one, without worrying about joy or sorrow, without worrying about pain or pleasure, gain or loss. Sukha dukkhe samay kritva labha labho gaya gaya. Number one. Number two, without worrying about the fruits of actions. Ma paleshu kadachana. Verse 47, chapter 2. Third, he says, which is considered the cardinal or the essence of the Gita, the essence of the Karma Yoga, rather verse 30 of chapter 3, where he says, absorbed in me, free of selfishness, free of hopes for the future, freed of restlessness of mind, perform your action. Immersed in me, immersed in the self, surrendering all actions to me. So he says that is the state of mind, and I hope we are seeing the parallels with what always spoke about. Selfishness, hopes for the future, right? All this restlessness of mind, all these are nothing but interferences that take away from our being absorbed in the self while working. This is what he calls vikarma. Karma plus vikarma. Equal to that, akarma. What is this akarma? Action performed thus, in keeping with one's swadharma, or in other words, with a purpose, and free from all these malices of the mind. Such an action, with the right attitude, that does not lead to the doer, does not leave impressions on the doer, such action he calls as akarma. The Lord goes on in the subsequent chapter 5 to explain the two shades of akarma. One is a state of akarma where the doer is intensely active, yet internally freed from the sense of doership, freed from all these malices that we spoke about in this, therefore fully absorbed in the state of akarma. That is one state of akarma. It's like a top. It's externally very, very active, but internally inactive. In some ways, it's a state where, like you see, a top that is spinning fast, spinning very, very, very fast, but it's still totally balanced. In fact, a top that doesn't spin fast is imbalanced. And that's an interesting observation for the corporate world of today, where we think there is intense activity. But if we have the right state of mind, the intense external activity married with it can result in total balance if it is done in this right frame of mind. So this is one aspect of akarma. The other aspect of akarma, which is nothing like but the other side of the coin, is nothing but a state of externally being totally inactive, but internally inspiring cosmic activity. It is what basically Lord Krishna inspiring Arjuna, he was inspiring the Pandavas. His inspiration was what gave them the ability to even fight such a gruesome battle for 18 long days. Without that, nothing would have happened. So it is the other side. In fact, when a top is spinning at infinite velocity or infinite rotational speed, it will appear stationary. So it is nothing but the other side of the coin. Now what the Lord argues is that akarma, defined like this, karma with the right attitude, swadharma with the right attitude, has several benefits. First of all, it's not just a general exhortation that please do this. It has concrete benefits, according to him, as he beautifully describes in different parts of the Gita. And I only understand some of them, so I'll share whatever I picked up. The first is, he says, it results in perfect action. Yoga, karma, sukaushala. Perfect action. Why? Because the mind is not cluttered with 50 things. It is totally focused on the present. That is the first benefit that it conjoins. The second benefit that it actually offers is that it leaves no stain on the doer. Naivam papama vapsyasi, he says. Tato yudhyaya yudhyascha naivam papama vapsyasi. You incur no sin in this killing if you are totally absorbed in the action with the right purpose and the right attitude. And in fact, it takes one to the stainless state, as he talks about in yet another verse, 51 of the second chapter, Padam Gacha, Gachanti Anam, Anamayam. Third, such an action does not tire the individual. This whole idea that we all struggle with today in the corporate world, oh, there's too much work, I'm getting very stressed, not at all. If we have the right attitude and orientation, if work is a joy, it can be a joy, it can be a source of energy as opposed to a drain on our energy. How do we do that? That is the benefit of what he describes, action performed this way. Fourth benefit is that it empowers and inspires everybody around us. It is not an action that only benefits us, it benefits the whole world. That is what he himself did in his capacity, his role, by inspiring the Pandavas to destroy evil. He re-established good for the entire society. So, and we'll come back to how it can help in the corporate world. And finally, it creates, like what the panel discussed earlier, it creates role models in society. These are not people who will stop working and be recluses because work inspires them. They will show, they will demonstrate through action benefit to all and become role models in society. So, from a very practical perspective, the link between the Gita and the management results is very evident. It results in a quality of work that not only benefits the manager, so-called manager, but benefits the entire system that is part, that is working, that he is working on. Right? So that is the attitude, that is the orientation of a Karma Yogi for whom self-development is the goal. The earnings and the rewards become means. They may initially be the goal, but over time, with action constantly with this background, it purifies them. So over time, the earnings and the rewards are the mere means. And as we observe them, as they develop themselves and evolve, with less and less effort, they'll be able to do more and more work. They become efficient, effective workers, razor-sharp workers, not boiling the ocean, as we would say in the world of management. 50 analysis, data, give me that. No, pointed, sharp working. On the other hand, an ordinary worker who's just working for benefit, think about such a manager. Such a manager, the goal itself is self-benefit. The means is some development. Okay, I'm learning something, but I'm really looking for my year-end bonus. And the amount of huffing and puffing that goes into it, I'm stressed and down, is enormous energy wasted. Now, the Lord does not leave it that way, as our esteemed predecessor spoke about. He also offers methods to get into this state of being. And that is what he starts with. There were many of the yogas that he enshrines later. But he starts with the idea of Jnana Yoga and particularly points out the three simple things. He says, the practice is, please, let's start training our mind to get one pointed. Practice number two, some degree of moderation under this whole scheme of Dhyana Yoga. Some moderation of all our faculties, no extremities. And the third is a positive, equanimous outlook. Positive attitude, looking for positive things, what are in the panel they describe as a cheerful orientation. Simple two, three orientations. So if I step back from both the work of Timothy Galway in the field of management and in the work of, and in what the Lord, elucidates in the Bhagavad Gita, there is an outer and an inner aspect of any activity that we are involved in. The inner aspect is as important as the outer aspect. The inner aspect too requires training. What is most crucial is to be able to get into that state of being. And if you think about this in the corporate world, if managers, a critical mass of managers in an organization have this sort of orientation, if we can imagine the sort of benefits that will take place, number one, what impact would it have on the productivity of such an organization at the most basic level? People focused on the work, focused on the action, fully immersed on it, not cluttered with 50 other things, fully absorbed in the work. Productivity of such an organization would work dramatically. Second, if we can visualize the quality of decision making in such an organization, when leaders start taking decisions without biases, but by being objective, the beautiful point that Ajay brought out last time about, what is right versus I am right, they're able to remain objective. The mind has to remain objective. The reality is the quality of decisions go up dramatically in an organization. Third, let us think about how interpersonal relationships and collaboration that is so important in organizations today take place, and the effectiveness of that when managers have lowest self-interest and the interest of others at heart. How will it work? It will work fantastically and it will benefit everybody. Everybody will win. And eventually, the final benefit is managers of this quality will be inspired people. People who work with a purpose in an organization, who kind of deliver the mission of an organization and not merely for bonuses. So the key thing, therefore, from all this, at least as far as I was able to intimate extract this, how do we really get into that refined beyond all this? The theory is one part of it, to awaken our awareness to get into that state of being. But the key is, how do we get to that state of being? That is the cardinal question to ask. And that is really what happened to Arjuna as well, because at the end of it, when asked, he said, yes, my delusion is gone. And how did it just go away? Could have it really gone away by hearing 700 verses, by listening to 700 verses? If that were true, many of us who heard the 700 verses of the Gita once would be completely devoid of all our delusions and we would be sthita pragnas. In fact, it is almost inconceivable that in the middle of the battlefield, 700 shlokas were actually even recited, that the conch was blown, everything was blown, the conditions were ready for arrows to be fired. In the middle of the battlefield, to conceive that 700 shlokas were actually recited, exchanged, and everybody was looking on. Maybe time came to a halt, but the alternate explanation of that is that Lord Krishna literally transmitted the condition of being at that state of awakening Krishna to Arjuna, to his own duty, and being in a state of inspiration, being in a state of contribution to society. With that attitude, he awakened Krishna, he transmitted the condition to Krishna, Lord Krishna transmitted that condition to Arjuna, and therefore Arjuna, who was just a little while ago arrogant, deluded, impotent, the greatest archer in the world, the most skillful archer in the world, one who was completely despondent, in a matter of a little while, he was transformed into somebody who was ready to act for a greater cause. So the key thing is, how do we actually get into that state of being quickly? Can we we experience that state of being. And this is where I would like to bring in the unique practice of heartfulness as a way to experience this condition of balance and equanimity. The primary technique here is nothing but some basic relaxation followed by meditation. And the idea is as follows. The most, as we spoke, the critical thing is to play the inner game. For that, training of the mind is required. Meditation is considered the most potent tool to train and regulate the mind. Meditation, that's point number one. Point number two is, meditation is nothing very abstract or archaic. It basically means thinking about the same thing for a period of time. That is all it means. It comes from the Latin word meditare, which means to be thinking about the same thing for a period of time. The practical insight is that depending on what we rest our mind on, we acquire the qualities of what we rest our mind on. It is a common experience. If we watch a horror movie, how are we going to feel? Are we going to feel very tranquil and still? We will be disturbed, isn't it? Same way, if we sit by the still waters of a deep ocean, or still sit by the still waters of a deep river and just observe that, how are we going to feel? If we rest our mind on that, we are going to acquire the tranquility that is possibly in that space, isn't it? It's a common experience. The whole thesis of heartfulness, again consistent with the Gita, is that all the infinite resources that are needed in a human being, the infinite potential that Timothy Calvin talks about as well, are present in the human in the heart, because the heart is the seat of divinity in any human being, and therefore presents an infinite potential. Which is what the Lord Himself says, Anamatma Gakesh Sarvabhutashayastitaha, that is like the heart of all human beings. So all we need is a way to access the infinite potential, the silent zone in the heart, and connect to that. And then by connecting to this higher state of being, we have attained what the Lord talks about, being absorbed in being. The whole idea of heartfulness is to be able to provide that access to the silent zone in the heart, which is otherwise very difficult to do normally. Okay? So that is really what this whole thing is about. And if you all are game, that is all I have to say at this point and now. If you are game, you can go into the realm of experience for the next 20 minutes or so, 25 minutes. Does that make sense? Good. So here is what we will do. We will go through a three-step process. The first step will last for about 5 minutes, the second for another 5 minutes, and the third for about 20 minutes or so. So it's going to take a little longer. In the first step, you will meditate on your own. Either by any technique that you've done, or how many of you have tried meditating before? Sure. So you're free to meditate by any technique or by the heartfulness method. Those of you who have not done anything, you can try the heartfulness method that we've talked about. So that is step one. Okay? Step two is we'll go through the simple relaxation and audio that Siddhartha will play. It's a simple, very simple thing, set of things to follow. Step three is we'll go through what is called a guided meditation, where I will be meditating along with you and potentially infusing something in you. For yourself, you can hopefully feel all these three steps. And I don't want to pre-conclude any experience. And as the panel said, let the emphasis be on experience. And after this experience, we will conclude by explaining the experience and connecting all the dots. Okay? So here is the method of meditation that you need to follow. Either in both step 1 and step 3. In step 1, for those of you who meditated with other methods and you want to do that, please go ahead and do that. When we stay, please start meditation. Please sit comfortably, close your eyes. And you make a gentle suggestion that the source of light is in the heart. A gentle suggestion turn your attention to the heart as if you're turning a TV and watching it. Naturally, thoughts will arise, but you're encouraged to ignore the thoughts and not make any attempt to concentrate. Just ignore them and relax. When you realize your mind has wandered, you simply gently, like you would call a child back home, you gently bring back the attention to the idea that there is divine light in the heart, okay, or the source of light in the heart, okay. You don't have to try and see any light either. When we say that's all, you may open your eyes and then observe how you feel at the end of that process. Okay? So the first step, we will do this for 5 minutes. You'll open your eyes, then we'll do some relaxation and continue with the third step of guided heartfulness meditation, where as far as you are concerned, you'll do the same thing. Okay? Are we good to go? Please sit comfortably and close your eyes and make your breath normal. Please start meditation.
So,
please observe your condition mentally now. We'll now move to the guided relaxation that will last for about 5 minutes and proceed to the guided meditation which will last for about 20 minutes. It's a very simple set of instructions at the end of which I'll say that's all for the week. Sit comfortably and close your eyes softly and gently. Let's begin with the toes. First, move your toes. Now feel them. Relax. Relax your ankles and feet. Feel energy move up from the earth. Feel it move up your feet to your knees. Relax in the legs. Relax your thighs. The energy moves up your legs. Relax. Now, deeply relax your hips, stomach, and waist. Relax your back. From the top to the bottom, your entire back is relaxed. Relax your chest and shoulders. Feel any tightness in your shoulders melting away. Relax each muscle in your forearms, your hands, right up to your fingertips. Relax the neck muscles. Move your awareness up to your face. Relax the jaws, mouth, nose, eyes, earlobes, facial muscles, all the way to the top of your head. Move your attention to your heart. Rest there for a little while. Feel immersed in the lightness you feel in your heart. Remain still and quiet, and slowly go deeper into yourself. Remain absorbed for as long as you want.
Start meditation.
possible. How many of you feel relaxed? Let me ask another question. How many of you felt the difference between the second time we meditated and the first 5 minutes? Do you feel any difference? First 5 minutes when you sat on your own and then the last. You realize it's been about 20 minutes since you sat. How many of you are surprised that you actually sat 20 minutes? So now let me take a couple of minutes to explain this experience and why we were able to actually sit and why many of you put your hands up when you said the second felt a little different from the first. In the first 5 minutes, it was what we call a placebo meditation. The active ingredient was actually missing when you were just meditating on your own. In the last 20 minutes in the third meditation, third step, when we did the meditation the second time around for about 20 minutes, a very subtle energy called transmission was infused into those meditating. This transmission is unique to heartfulness and it has a very, very interesting effect. First and foremost, it facilitates the process of meditation, which is otherwise very difficult to do on one's own. It requires hours and hours and hours of practice to be able to feel anything. Transmission facilitates the process of meditation, number one. Number two, it awakens the divine essence that is actually in each of us and therefore makes us get absorbed in ourselves. That is why when we came out of it, many people said, I feel fresh and relaxed. Because in the self, there is energy. It is not without reason that Lord Krishna says we absorb into the self. There is energy in us. So transmission awakens that presence in us and helps us access our own, what we call potential, the self. Third thing that transmission does is it eliminates the source of interferences that we were talking about in what Timothy Galloway spoke about, performance minus potential minus interference. It eliminates these interferences. And what are these interferences? They are at the root of it, they are nothing but impressions that are settled in the heart because of experiences in the past. Maybe when we were a little child, we jumped off a swimming board and we got afraid of swimming pools. But there are so many impressions settled in us due to our past actions that create all the thoughts in the first place. This meditation eliminates these impressions that are settled in the heart and the source of it, and therefore over time as these interferences go away, our ability to access our potential goes up. Therefore the negative qualities like fear, greed, lack of confidence, all these things are slowly eliminated from the root without our conscious effort, without our having to renounce anything through austerities or difficult practice, and in its place positive qualities like confidence, courage, selflessness, and above all, love for all is infused. Right? So if I step back and draw a summary to the session, the essence of all, whether it's Bhagavad Gita, whether it's the field of management or any field of life, the essence is the same. Essentially says any activity has an outer and an inner component. The inner component is driven by the mind. That is as important, the attitude is as important. But to do that, regulation of the mind is required. To regulate the mind, forcing the mind will not work. A natural way of actually linking the mind to the higher self helps it dissolve of everything that is lower. By like a little child, when you're stuck with a toy, you give it another interesting toy, it will naturally move to that. So a natural way of regulating the mind is required. And that is really what, if you tie it back, heartfulness really does. It brings this mind to a state of regulation, it brings our entire faculties to a state of moderation, which is what is called balance. Samadhi is nothing plus sam plus adi. Adi means the original, sam means balance, the balance that exists in the original state. That is really what transmission infuses. For those of you who are interested in being able to practice this on your own, this is offered free of charge. You may, there is, I understand, I gather that there is a booth outside, so you may just give your names. You will need to take two other sessions like this, 20-25 minutes each, during the course of the week with some trainer or the other, either in person or remote. And then you will be able to practice on your own and be able to receive this transmission on your own. So those of you who are interested are welcome to do this, it's free of cost. One final parallel between everything that we spoke about is the idea of the seeker and the guide. The entire Gita took place only because even the greatest of warriors, Arjuna, surrendered himself and told Lord Krishna, "Listen, I am in a state of confusion. I do not know what is right or wrong. I am a dilemma. You are my teacher. I surrender unto you. Please guide me." In the corporate world, this is what we call in well-functioning organizations, mentorship. It requires an apprentice, it requires a mentor. Both have to be. The apprentice should be open to receiving this, and there needs to be a mentor of caliber. And there be no Lord Krishna to guide Arjuna and transmit the condition that we just experienced, the idea of transmission, to actually transmit the condition, helping experience the condition, they would not have been a Gita. Equally so, had he not sought help, they would not have been a Gita. In the heartfulness meditation way as well, we have over 300,000 seekers worldwide who practice this way. There are over 5,000 trainers worldwide who participate in offering these people the practice free of charge. Like me, there are many, many others. And behind us, there is a living guide whose only role is to do two things. One, serve as a role model, so that of one who can lead a normal life and yet contribute to a higher cause. And number two, serve as the source of this transmission, without which transformation is virtually impossible. So I hope many of you will use the benefit of this unique way that is at your doorstep free of cost. We are at your service. All the very best. Thank you for the opportunity.